Otherwise, we'll begin with questions you can have. This is really for dialogue and discussion, so we don't have a lot of formal presentations or anything. Stuff I put on the board up there is just a framework that we all can use it as a discussion. But I think what we will do is just have each person on the panel introduce themselves, just so you kind of know where they're coming from and what aspect of this
I'm Patty James. Can you hear me okay? I'm a physician assistant. I work with Dr. Lucinda Bateman. And in January, we did 10 years of the year. And so my approach to this topic is going to be from a clinical aspect, diagnosis and treatment.
Hi, I'm Matthew
Mellon.
I'm a neurologist, and I'm working with the Oak Center right now in research in Boston. And so we heard she's very specialized in neuropathic pain and small fiber pain.
My name is Lee Smith. I'm an internist. For a long time, I'm just in fibromyalgia for 20 years. And I've been very interested in not only the clinical aspects and how to treat it, but the neurobiology of it, and what's going on, causes, and things of that nature. So we're going to just start with a kind of questions that Abby has.
Let's talk through a fundamental one, and this is, how does one get a diagnosis of fibromyalgia? I think if I were a patient who had not yet found the diagnosis that you suspect you do have it, if it were me, I would do some research, try to get some reliable resources online to start reading. The American College of Rheumatology, the National Fibromyalgia Association, the CFIDS.org Association, Solve CFS. Many of these websites address both chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia. So educate yourself about what the diagnostic criteria are.
Can you name those help pages again?
The American College of Rheumatology. These are the people who have written the diagnostic criteria and revised them in 2010. The National Fibromyalgia Association, NFA, SolveCFS.org. Those are just beginning. There are many, many websites. And then, do a little research about the criteria, do some reading about it, find out, think about it, think if it fits you. There are things, of course, that overlap with chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia that are tested for and looked at and ruled out in many cases, but you have to have a starting point. You would see your primary care physician, take your printout of the 2010 criteria with you, and say, I think this may be you. I have this, and this. What do you think? And here's the new criteria that was revised. What do you think? Where should we begin working out whether it's fibromyalgia or if it's something else?
There are a number of things that can cause chronic widespread muscle pain. Certainly the most common is fibromyalgia. And we're not talking about swollen arthritis, that's a different issue, widespread arthritis pain. We're talking about chronic widespread muscle pain without a lot of swollen inflamed joints. There's some interesting and important pieces that have been expanded in the diagnostic criteria, and that is it goes beyond just the pain. Half of people with fibromyalgia have irritable bowel syndrome, where the nervous system isn't responding not only too much to pain signals, but too much to gut signals, and so you may have diarrhea, constipation, bloating, and so on. About 60% will have headaches, and frequently they have sort of a migraineous pattern through them. Where the nervous system is also over-responding to light, and to sound, and to smells. which you see with libraries, for example. Maybe a third will have periodical bladder. When you do the tests, it's not the bladder that's really the problem, it's the nervous system over-responding to bladder signals. So you'll get urinary frequencies, and you look at urinalysis, and it looks normal. And if you don't have any of those other parts, so fibromyalgia is more than just the pain, it's this twitching, over-responsive nervous system to a lot of things, and even anxiety is over-responding to stress signals. If you have none of those other things, then you want to be sure and look for some of these less common problems, which might seem called widespread pain without that stuff, but such as hypothyroidism or inflammatory muscle disease, polymyositis, for example, or severe vitamin D deficiency. But most of those don't have these other nervous system sensitive problems. They're just pain in muscles. And if you have those other things, take your list of criteria into your doctor and say, look, I've got all this stuff.
I think that's the beauty of that revised version of criteria, is that it does address those basically kind of qualified different things that we now see as the same.
Okay, here's the next sort of basic question. Is fibromyalgia genetic or hereditary? The answer is yes. If a person has fibromyalgia, a first degree relative has 7 times the chance of developing it. But this is sort of interesting too. Even somebody who doesn't have the full symptoms of fibromyalgia will often push on the tender points. They'll be a little more tender, even though they don't have a lot of the widespread pain. So far, there have been 3 or 4 genes that have been identified. Now, Al Light is talking about a whole other pattern of genes in there this morning. But several of these genes play have a role to do with inhibitory neurotransmitters. But let me give you what I mean by that. This little diagram, we're representing here out in the tissue, there will be something causing pain. Doesn't matter what it is, a pain generator. That could be peripheral neuropathy, as one of those. That signal comes into the spinal cord, it connects with a second order neuron that carries the signal up to the brain, and then the brain sends signals back down to inhibit the pain. And there are thus far, more to this, the 3 that have been classically studied of neurotransmitters that are released down here to inhibit the pain are serotonin, norepinephrine, and dopamine. Most of the genes identified that are associated with fibromyalgia have to do with the function of those 3 neurotransmitters. If you lack inhibition, so the problems with inhibition, if you lack inhibition, a little pain signal coming in, it's amplified to a big pain signal going out. And so it's an amplification problem. And not only the pain, but of the gut signals that I mentioned, or the light, or the stress, it's the nervous system over-responding to stimuli. And which of those genes you get may determine the pattern of the fibromyalgia. If the genes are involving some of the serotonin receptors and things, you may have more trouble with anxiety and trouble sleep. If it has more to do with this, with the norepinephrine and the dopamine, you may be more tired and can't think. And you might have both. So clinically, we can get a handle a little bit on which of these directions to go. But the answer to the question is yes, it's quite genetic. You'll be genetically vulnerable, and then you'll have something that triggers the whole event. And it can be an acute pain problem, it can be an infection, it can be missing sleep, something that kind of triggers some achiness, and the nervous system takes off with the sensitivity, and the cause of it is gone. It just takes on a life of its own. Yes?
Can I just ask a follow-up question? We're talking about those specific there are tests they can do, right? Like urine tests where they actually try to measure the different levels of those types of things to see where you might be deficient. Is there a value in doing those types of testing?
Okay, great question. So we got serotonin, norepinephrine and dopamine. Now, there's much more to this story. But the answer is no, not in the blood, not in the urine. The place this has been identified is in the cerebral spinal fluid. That's not practical to do, and you don't need to do it. I mean, you just know that this is going on if you have that whole syndrome, if you're lacking inhibition.
So I have just something to add to that. So that would be like medications that are like the SSRIs or the SNRIs work well, like Cialis and Valtrin, Prozac, because they help those inhibitors.
Okay, so the question is, some of the medications approved for fibro, like Cymbalta and Savella, are SNRIs. Okay, so they're acting on serotonin and norepinephrine. And yes, they work because they improve the inhibition. They also work for depression. But, you know, most people who originally appear with fibromyalgia don't have clinical depression. Over time, that can develop because it's the same neurotransmitter. Up in the brain, well, let's just use an illustration. The SNRIs, those antidepressants, are also used for anxiety disorder. Well, if you think about this, if we were to ask, why do we have pain? What's pain for? It's a warning, right? It protects you. You know, if I put my hand on a hot stove, I can pull my hand off the stove. But we forget that signal going up here to my sensory cortex telling me the stove is hot also goes through the emotional part of the brain and makes me afraid to touch the stove. The fear and the pain are part of the same protective mechanism. But when you lack inhibition, it becomes dysfunctional. There's too much pain. There's too much fear. Anxiety disorder. It's no longer protective because of the lack of these same neurochemicals. The pain and the fear are running together with some of the same neurochemicals. So yes, the SNRIs work. Whether or not depression is there, they work for the pain. They'll also help the anxiety. Yes.
Because you say inhibition, you're not talking about, you know, my personal inhibitions about whatever.
No.
It's the system.
Biochemical inhibition of pain signal going up. Or
so it's
gut
like suppressing it?
Yeah, it's keeping it in control. Allowing it to happen, but not too much. You know, a little too much, you're good, right? Just balance.
Yes. Does gabapentin work similarly?
No. The SNRIs work here on these neurotransmitters to improve inhibition. The gabapentin, and this is also true of pregabalin, there it is, work down here in this synapse to, okay, that's to the glycolates as much. This is this blown up synapse where the nerves come together. So we've got the incoming pain signal connecting with the second neuron and the inhibition, this represented right here. So what happens is a pain signal comes in and releases pain neurotransmitters like substance P and glutamine that fire off this second neuron. And in fibromyalgia, not only do you lack these inhibitors, but there's too much of the substance P and glutamine in the cerebral spinal cord.
Too much of
the pain activating neurotransmitters and too little of the inhibiting ones. Now that's not clinical tests that you do out in the regular laboratory, this is research tests. The way that these work, the pregabalin and the gabapentin, is in an end result, you get less release of the substance P and glutamine. So they're reducing signals going up, and the SNRIs were improving inhibition coming down. We often add them together.
So then those would not be an antidepressant like the other?
No, they're not antidepressants, they're anticonvulsants.
What about is it Claritin?
Claritin, that's pregabalin. Yeah. If you think of convulsions are twitching, over-responsive nervous system. You know, you're supposed to light and everything goes bananas. And so what the anticonvulsants do is help the nervous system be less twitchy and less sensitive to stimulating stimuli. So that's why they're complementary.
I want to learn more about this because I know you want to spend your whole time on this, but to me, this is so crucial to understand. Is there a good place to read that type of information on our website?
It's on a lot of websites.
One you can recommend. It's really hard to say it because there's so much bad information out there.
Let's see.
Like, will this talk?
Okay, go to offerutah.org.
Okay.
And look up some of the monthly meetings and the conferences. They're all on there. And many different people are talking about this.
Okay.
Yes?
I just want to make sure I've got this right. So in fibromyalgia, you lack the inhibitors, and those are the things that inhibit the pain and stuff.
Yes.
And you have too much of the pain signal.
Right. Too much of the stimulators.
Stimulators.
To really the
volume
turning down. Neurotransmitter. Yes.
When you mentioned about the nerves can make your bladder basically go haywire, is there anything that they can do to fix that?
To fix what?
The bladder, if there's problems with it, yeah.
Well, that's a whole other discussion. The first step is to treat the whole nervous system. See, when you're using these kind of medicines, they're not just treating symptoms. It's in sort of mainstay. There's a whole lot more. But you just quiet down the nervous system, and often the bladder will quiet down. This is where it gets sort of interesting, though. If the bladder problem, this twitchy bladder, goes too long, you start getting this substance P that we're talking about going backwards down into the bladder, and it starts getting inflamed in the bladder. Substance P in the nervous system activates these immune cells called glia cells and causes some neurogenic inflammation in the nervous system. And if it goes backwards the other way out to the periphery, it can cause inflammation out there and could even contribute to some of the small fibromyalgia.
When we think about bladder problems, we sort of think of them as irritable bladder, kind of in the way that you think of irritable bowel, and that kind of larger sense of the worked-up nervous system. Some people, however, have interstitial cystitis, which may be a reflection of that inflammatory downstream phenomenon. We don't really know that. But there are specific treatments for interstitial cystitis, if that's what we're looking for. I wanted to get to this next question is, where can I find a skin test for small fiber peripheral neuropathy and gene expression testing? And this is all based on the lectures we just heard. We were talking about this up here before we did the study. We don't know about the skin biopsies yet. Probably Dr. Lang's out. But, we're trying to figure out how to approach that. Hopefully we can initiate some sort of study among patients who show a cluster of symptoms that look like small fiber peripheral neuropathy, and involve them in a study and begin to initiate a round of investigations in people who are locally. At this point, we don't have that. But we have Dr. Offender's and Dr. Lang's work to look at, and if we get a study like that, we'll probably end up shooting examples.
The skin biopsy is easy to do. It's done all the time. It's not necessary for this. For other things, we do punch biopsy. The dermatologists do them all the time, some urologists do them. And what we can do, this is not set up, but Patty's saying, if we just get a dermatologist on board, knows what we're doing, send what we're doing, skin biopsy, or you can do it right, many primary care doctors can do the skin biopsy. Not if it's not simple, it's not hard.
Yes, so many doctors can perform it, and then as a start, we can build a connection and process them first, and then we can build something here.
But at this point, we need a special pathology lab to do it. Special district chemical management, that's staining. The other part of this question is getting gene expression testing. The only way I know of right now is to volunteer for Dr. Light's study. So I would encourage all of you who are interested in that in contacting me and see if we can get the next study. We love those studies.
And Dr. Bateman's office would be a nice connection into that.
Yeah, our research.
By reaching the lights directly in the science lab.
Our research office, yes.
Can you take a list of those of us? Like, I've read about that problem, the short fiber thing online, and it was like I had a symptom of it. Can you take a list of names today that if you get a study going, you could contact us?
I can, but what we might do is call our research member. We don't really have a study yet, so typically we don't accumulate data. We don't have anywhere to put it on people. But, you know, it would be a bad thing if you emailed at the website or called the research number that we have and ask them if they're feeding on us. I could ask that question too. Mention it to them.
So, Dr. Lang, would you skin biopsy everybody with fibromyalgia, or it's not clean?
That's a very good question. So, not everybody who has fibromyalgia should have a skin biopsy. That is not what I know, what I tend to say. It's actually quite a tough decision who gets a skin biopsy and who doesn't. And it really depends on evaluation of symptoms and then the neurological exam that can be performed only by a neurologist, can be performed by a PCP or other professions. And only if this leads up to the suspicion to have that this patient has more polyneuropathy, then a skin biopsy should be performed.
If a primary care physician would do it, do they take a sample and then send it off to, say, you? I mean, do they get all that information? Do they know to do that? Or your dermatologist, will they know to send it? I mean, do you have to tell them? Do you have to tell them to send it to you?
I don't think they would know because they're not as interested as we are. It's our business, our clinic. Is interested in this, so we would probably have to provide the information to them.
Well, the reason I asked the question is more from a forensic point of view, sending clients to have the biopsy done to show that there is the small vessel polyneuropathy. But you say anybody can do the skin sample, but who can do the actual testing and know what they're looking for?
Yeah, that's the trick right now. Probably I would send it to the lady that saw it.
We do test based on clinical presentation, and so we choose the people appropriate to the test, we hold, rather than doing forensic work that direction, basically. So if it were, if the patient showed very clear signs of small fiber neuropathy, then it may be appropriate. It's still in
research. We might want to start a little side business and charge a little more for the skin biopsy. And then we can pay for it, and you don't have to worry about it.
Let me give you a claim without the way I would think about it. Now, mind you, I haven't had this as brand new, so this is, I have a lot of experience back this up. But quite a number of my fibro patients have signs that sound like peripheral neuropathy. What that means is things like burning and stinging in the extremities, your hands and feet and the skin, as opposed to deep muscle aching in the back and neck and so on. Now, mind you, you may well, you're likely to have all that deep muscle pain too, but if you also have these sort of peripheral symptoms, or if the autonomic nervous system isn't working quite right, that could just raise my suspicion to check for peripheral neuropathy. As we say that, if you ask what drugs are used to treat the peripheral neuropathic pain, they're the same things that are used for fibromyalgia, because neuropathic pain is, if you kind of think about it, you've got a damaged neuron out here that's the pain generator. Instead of it being something else stimulating the nerve itself, because you send signals in, and with neuropathic pain of any kind, the nervous system starts to wind up and hypersensitize. And the medicines that work for neuropathic pain are the Olson's SNRIs. The same thing we treat fibromyalgia with is what we would treat the peripheral neuropathic pain. The thing that's different that Dr. Lang made clear, I think, in his presentation is if you have this peripheral neuropathy, there could be something else causing it other than the fiber. So you might have vitamin B12 deficiency, or diabetes, a whole host of things that you then want to check out if the biopsy was positive. I don't know the answer to this, but I know if you treated this other cause of the peripheral neuropathy, I'm not sure you'll get rid of the fibromyalgia. You still have to treat the neuropathic pain. Often interstitial cystitis, which is an inflammatory problem begins with irritable bladder. And as you get these constant signals, it's going to be the bladder, these constant signals coming in and release substance P, it's a pain activating transmitter, but also is pro-inflammatory. And sometimes it'll start being released backwards into the bladder and cause inflammation in the mind. That's been proven in animals. So there may be a connection, but interstitial cystitis is not part of fibromyalgia. Could conceivably be a consequence of untreated cosmic batteries. It's theoretical and by some analysis.
This is a good question because it addresses what a lot of other people are asking. Where is another place to go in the Salt Lake area for proper fibromyalgia testing? But getting into the chronic fatigue clinic is so difficult. My primary care doctor is unsure how to test for it. At this point, we don't have specific tests for it, although the doctors lie are working on biomarkers. How this is generally works is that fibromyalgia is diagnosed based on the diagnostic criteria. None of those criteria involve any testing in the sense of a test specific for fibromyalgia. However, we do routine baseline tests to rule out other things. Thyroid, rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, the usual things you won't heard.
What if you have the most of all of us here?
What I wanted to say was, we are overwhelmed by the number of people who need to come into our clinic, and we're really sort of helpless in the face of servicing all these people. So what we typically try to do is to suggest people educate themselves, know the criteria, and work with their primary care physicians. Try to find a primary care provider who is interested in working with you and try not to overwhelm them with all the symptoms at one time, because in primary care, they have a very limited amount of time because they are not reimbursed very well for lengthy visits. And you want to stay in business as a primary care provider, you pretty much have to have short visits. That's just reality. And so if you can find a primary care provider who will listen to you, and in a short visit, you can say, okay, this is visit one. I think I have fibromyalgia. And here's why I think, here are the criteria. What do you think? And, you know, do you think we should do some testing to rule out something else? Do you think that we could, once you've made a decision about that, could we then talk about pain or my sleep? Or, and you, you know, we advise providers to try to break it up into single topic visits once the diagnosis is made. Because that's about what most people can handle when they're practicing, unless they have an unusual clinic.
What about a psychiatrist as a complement? Because they're dealing with a lot of the same types of medications, and I wonder if there are many psychiatrists who are very well educated about fibromyalgia as well.
Maybe a few, probably not many.
There are a few, but this is an interesting question. Fibromyalgia is so common that it doesn't fit in a niche. It's the symptoms are like rheumatology, but the mechanisms are neurological. But neurologists deal with nerve damage diseases, well, peripheral neuropathy, but they don't deal with nerve dysfunction problems. Psychiatrists deal with nerve dysfunction problems, but they don't deal with a lot of pain. And the primary care doc doesn't have enough time to really put all the pieces together. So kind of, it's an orphan problem. And once it's figured out and create a plan, then the primary care doc can often carry out that plan quite nicely. Changes and nudges have to make here.
Just as an aside to that, there have been a couple of questions about rheumatologists. Rheumatologists typically want to treat rheumatologic disease, which is a bit more well-defined than fibromyalgia. Rheumatology is not hugely well-defined either, but there are antibodies they can test for. And so rheumatologists, there are occasional rheumatologists who diagnose and treat fibromyalgia, but not many. There aren't enough rheumatologists to do the rheumatology. So we don't usually refer people to rheumatology, more primary care.
The kind of psychiatrist could be helpful is if there is a concomitant depression or anxiety disorder. And incidentally, fibromyalgia is more associated with anxiety disorders than it is depression, because of what I just described before. You know, the nervous system is always responding to stress. There is a subset, and I think I need to mention this here, with fibromyalgia. Now, this is in the group that some of us see resistant kind of problems running into, but there is a subset that have mechanisms that kind of sound like bipolar disorder. And they don't always respond well to the SNRIs. You have to use some anticonvulsant kind of drugs and some other types of things instead of SNRIs. And interestingly enough, if you go out and look, you'll find case reports of rather dramatic responses of fibromyalgia to lithium in people who have that subset. Now, I don't want to make this a generalized thing. It's not the majority, but if things aren't going the way you want to screen for symptoms, a lot of anxiety, cyclic symptoms that kind of comes and goes, of pain, irritability, anger, impulsiveness. It's not a classic bipolar thing, but it's a mechanistically it's like bipolar. And when you treat that, it really does help pain more. And that's where a psychiatrist could be helpful.
So on that note, with doctors, I'm I was diagnosed in the early 90s by Deborah Robinson, and then she passed away, and at that time they said, just train your GP. So
I did that, but then this last year I had a severe relapse and lost my job. And I'm trying to get on disability, and my doctor's just like not really sure how to fill out proper paperwork for disability. She's willing to fill it out, but you know, how do you rate someone with fibromyalgia? Because some days it's good, some days it's really bad, you know?
You might consider going to a PM&R doc.
That's what I was trying to figure out, how to find them.
Yeah, physical medicine and rehab, and they deal with chronic pain all the time in a multidisciplinary way. That may be a field that...
Can you look up PMR?
Yeah, PMR, physical medicine and rehab specialists, and they do disability things a lot. And Lauren will be here to talk about you.
PMR?
PMR, physical medicine and rehab. He's an attorney dealing with disability problems. He probably has some good connections. However, if I may, Mr. Bowl, it's very true that this could become disabling. However, if your focus is on getting disability, it's really hard to get better. If you're constantly having to prove how disabled you are instead of thinking in terms of ability from a medical standpoint, that's a problem. I understand the issue. Some people really need some help, but it ought to be temporary with the idea of working into ability, not constantly improving.
Right. Well, I've always tried to work with the fibromyalgia since 94, so I have successfully, but I think I got re-traumatized and had a relapse that I haven't come out of that one. But I do need to support myself.
I understand. It's no concern.
Sounds interesting.
Yeah, a question here. It says excessive sweating when intent on anything, even non-physical or physical, like packing.
That's my question about that. This is another one from
Federal. Excessive sweating.
I don't know if this has any connection to fibromyalgia. I just, and I know there's, you know, the change that's from the book, you're going to take the cremation course. Yeah. But for years, I just start sweating so excessively, even if I'm trying to organize for packing, like, okay, this, and I'm thinking in a hurry, or I'm doing something in a hurry. Just excessive sweat, and I don't have any idea that has anything to do with fibromyalgia.
Well, okay, the first thing you have to ask is what medicine you take. Because any of the norepinephrine drugs, SNRIs, tricyclines, like amitriptyline, can make you sweat. There's ways to get rid of it. The norepinephrine has two effects. It's a stress hormone. So out in the periphery, it revs you up. And maybe makes pain worse out in the periphery. But centrally, it acts on a different kind of receptor, one of the genes that is talked about in there, the alpha 2 receptor, that quiets things down. So let me just describe this. This is a natural feedback mechanism. You get too much norepinephrine, it's revving you up in the periphery. It feeds back on the nervous system to shut itself down. And the peripheral part makes you sweat. You know, you've been stressed out, you sweat. Well, how do you treat it? There is a medication, two or three medications, that block that peripheral revving up receptor. And what you really want with norepinephrine is the quieting one that quiets the pain. So you can take this medication, just gets rid of the sweats.
What is it?
Well, it's things like terazosin or crazosin. They're some of the old blood pressure pills. And the sweats will usually just disappear. There is, however, a downside. And that is, when you block that activating receptor, you might gain more weight. You're aware of that.
Hey, I also have ADD and I take Adderall. Is that also the same type of
Well, yes and no. It's not a norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor, but what it does in the brain is release more norepinephrine than dopamine. And sometimes it can be helpful additive, and it depends on the rest of the story as to whether that's okay.
So it might be my medication.
Yes. And that can make you sweat.
Yeah. Adderall?
Yeah.
Well, I just gone to my primary care doctor, and after having CT scans, and they said all my insides are perfect and everything, he thinks that I have fibromyalgia. And with my bipolar medication and my ADHD medication, he had put me on amitriptyline. I noticed that it just like exacerbated all the pain that I was having. I mean, is stuff like that normal? I mean.
Okay, yeah, that's what I was saying before, that it's bipolarity, it's a different problem. You've got these inhibitory neurotransmitters that stimulate receptors to block this pain signal. But the problem with the bipolar mechanisms is the receptors are not working, and the membranes are too sensitive. So sometimes when you raise those neurotransmitters with an SNRI or amitriptyline, it stimulates these twitchy receptors. That's what we do, is block those receptors first, and then the other meds can block more. But it gets a little trickier, and this illustrates the point. Fibromyalgia is not one thing. There are a lot of entrees in this, much like you heard of, like a piece of milk. Yes.
I just wanted to validate what she was saying. My physician, Mary Nutal, put me on amitriptyline, and it not only exacerbates my symptoms, but it puts me a great deal of confusion, and I have amitriptyline toxicity in the hospital. It messed me up, you know. And I'm wondering, and I told him,
In that circumstance where you get paradoxical responses, the quieting aggravates things, think about this mechanism of you want to use these quieting anticonvulsants and some things called neuroleptics that quiet in a different direction rather than the SNRIs. If you get paradoxical reaction, just think about this kind of bipolar mechanism.
Amitriptyline is used a lot in chronic pain treatment, though, so you shouldn't rule it out as a potential therapy. It's used for a lot of generalized pain syndromes, chronic pelvic pain, interstitial cystitis, irritable bowel syndrome. But it does have the tendency to increase your serum level of other drugs, which is a possible problem if you're on several other drugs. It may be an interaction issue rather than the drug itself.
Some of these sometimes try to avoid palatine. That was my original, amitriptyline and palatine together.
That's fine. Yeah, the gabapentinoid doesn't have much drug interaction with anything. Amitriptyline does.
Dose dependent. Our doses of things we weren't here for.
Is there any particular medication that could be used for fibromyalgia? I was in the drugstore and I asked the pharmacist, and she goes, well, you can take ibuprofen, but I wouldn't take it too long. But the person who gave my diagnosis with fibromyalgia was actually a physical therapist intern. And when I said something to him, he goes, well, I don't know anything about it, but he prescribed something, and I never got a pill because it was $360. And he said I could eliminate this other medication, acetylcholine, which is for depression, if I took this. And I'm just going, okay, I'm totally
confused. So this enters another large area. Patty, how would you respond? What about the usual analgesics required for fibromyalgia?
You know, some people get benefit from ibuprofen and Celebrex and those. First of all, what I find, and as people get older, the pain is often multifactorial. It's not, as we get older, just fibromyalgia many times, number one. Secondly, there's a whole host of drugs that we use for treating pain. That includes some that you've talked about, the SNRI antidepressants, anticonvulsants, amitriptyline, the tricyclic antidepressants. muscle relaxants. We're now starting to try out low-dose naltrexone. And so there are other kinds of anti-inflammatory approaches we think that are going to appear in the future that address a different kind of inflammatory cascade among our patients. So ibuprofen, if you have arthritis along with your fibromyalgia, it could be helpful. I love NSAIDs personally, but you know, they do have their disadvantages and they don't work for a lot of fibro patients for generalized pain.
And if I may just emphasize what Patty has said, for fibro alone, the typical analgesics like NSAIDs like ibuprofen, acetaminophen, even opiates, don't work well for this hypersensitivity kind of pain or the peripheral neuropathic pain. But remember, fibromyalgia may be just amplifying pain caused by something else in the periphery. And something else in the periphery may respond to those kind of meds. We ought to make a comment about the opiates. Opiates can be helpful on a bad day, but if you take them around the clock, you actually activate a mechanism that increases the hypersensitivity. And so you start noticing your dose is creeping and the pain is still bad, and it's really hard to get off of them. So for fibro, studies with opiates, harder than you know, a bad day here and there, are not good. Now, the problem is, if you have an opiate for a bad day, you know, every day kind of hurts. So people start wanting to take them more, and so that's a problem. There are a couple of opiates that don't have that pro-hyperalgesic effect, that they're not worsening the sensitivity. One's called Tenadol, and one's called Suboxone. But generally speaking, you're better to go these other ways and non-pharmacological ways that quiet the nervous system sensitivity.
What was your name? Suboxone?
Suboxone, that's buprenorphine, is a generic name, buprenorphine and propanazole. But their last dish efforts.
Okay, so quiet for what?
Pardon?
These medications quiet.
Well, there are two opiates that are not worsening the hypersensitivity.
Okay.
That's pretty good. I wouldn't encourage you all to go out and try to get those particular opiates. Yes. Yeah, so if there is something else going on, the anti-inflammatories may be useful.
And then the other thing, the energy was the ribose and carnitine that Dr. Theobald suggested, and that really made it so I could function all day long taking that three times a day. What was some spread of that? It's ribose and carnitine, and if you read Dr. Theobald's work, it talks about a lot of these things in here. This was the most help to me. And I'm working all day long. I used to, you know, once in a while I have to take rest, but last year was total loss for me.
Do you have suggestions on other supplements that people might use?
Yeah, sometimes people use magnesium for pain. Dosing that several times a day. By the time we see people in our clinic, we've tried a lot of non-prescription approaches, and nothing really stands out to me, to be honest.
There is a subgroup, this is kind of, I think, important if you regard to some supplements. There's a subgroup that have a hard time making these neurotransmitters because of a genetic problem making an active vitamin necessary to produce them. It's called methylfolate. And
about a third of the population has trouble making the methylfolate from the vitamins that you folic acid. And you can just give the methylfolate in that group. You can actually test for that clinically, for that gene, and see if you're one of that group. So methylfolate, methyl B12, may in fact be helpful and have been shown in diabetic peripheral neuropathy to actually help start growing the neurons. But it's a subgroup, and you can be tested to see if that's appropriate.
I have a nice broad question here. What would you consider a complete program for fibromyalgia syndrome? How important are exercise, diet, stress management, medications, yoga, all of those? I would say, from my point of view, you want self-management is huge, along with symptomatic treatment if you need it. And stress management is a really important thing. Physical exercise, generally, fibromyalgia patients benefit from exercise. They're generally more tolerant of it than chronic fatigue syndrome patients. But you still have to be careful because, as we were seeing on Dr. Light's data, that the fibromyalgia patients also have post-exertional malaise, which is, I have that question here too. So you have to be careful with exercise, but you have to keep working on not becoming deconditioned. So that's all very important. Diet, we're learning a lot about diet. I can't say wholesale that there's one diet that really works for fibromyalgia, but there are a subset of patients who do well on a no-gluten diet. There are some people who do well on what we call the FODMAPs diet, which is, these are diets that avoid fermentable sugars and carbohydrates. You can research those things online. FODMAPs is newer than gluten-free, of course. So, in general, we think that people do better on a low-sugar, low-refined carbohydrate diet because we think that's a pro-inflammatory kind of way of eating. It probably predisposes people to metabolic syndrome or pre-diabetes states where their bodies are going to ache more and be more fatigued. So if you want to add on some fatigue and achiness, then eat a high-carb, high-sugar diet. And most of us kind of know that, but I think people really do feel it if they can do a good trial of living without those things. Some people just do much better.
I think that what Patty's been telling you about is actually a very important part of the whole story. And there's some biology to this. In the brain, the fear and suffering come from a part of the brain called the amygdala. The amygdala is part of our, we share it with reptiles, it's to protect you. And it sees me over here as separate and is fearful and angry and comparative and anytime you rev up the amygdala, which is, this is on overdrive in the fibroid, and anytime you rev it up, the nervous system revs up and becomes on guard, protecting, and over-responsive. In the prefrontal cortex, this is the wise part of the brain. And the wise part of the brain is in constant dialogue with the amygdala on functional MRI scanning. It's the part that's saying, hey, cool it, don't get too excited, we can handle this, don't give up, call focus. Okay. There's another little part called the anterior cingulate that's the loving and compassionate part. These two work together, and if you rev these up, you shut this down. Or if you rev this up, you shut them. That's your thinking part. That's where you have trouble with fiber problems. Okay. There are a host of non-pharmacological approaches. There are often meditative approaches. There are simple daily practices that get you into the prefrontal loving part of the brain, and you just practice them. And as you practice them, this has actually been shown on functional MRIs. For example, mindfulness meditation, just meditating in here three or four days a week for a half hour, literally shuts down the amygdala, and you get less suffering, even if the pain is there. It doesn't bother you as much. So there are a whole host of very important things in stress resilience training is about how to respond through your wisdom and your compassion rather than your judgment and your fear. And it's very possible to do that. You have to practice doing it. And literally what happens is you start growing new neurons in that part of the brain called neuroplasticity. Instead of growing neurons into pro-pain neurons, they're growing them in the part that's quieting down the sensitivity. And I think this is a very important piece to this whole puzzle. Yoga has been shown to work. What yoga is, you put yourself in an uncomfortable position, and then you get centered and focused. The uncomfortable position is not controlling me, I'm controlling me. And that gets you up into this brain. It's very useful stuff. And the yoga has shown to be a reduce your pain scores by about 2.5 points. You know, you're 6.5, which may be a little disabling when you get down to 4. It's not disabling. Yes?
Before I knew I had fibromyalgia, I started going to yoga. It's kind of like a yoga Pilates mix class. And I could just tell that I needed that. I just knew that I needed that and that it was going to help me a lot. And then, you know, the pain got worse and I went in and got diagnosed. But it really does. It really helps.
However, remember Patty's caution, pacing. There's yoga and then there's yoga.
Yeah.
Okay, and there's some wonderful yoga teachers that are very familiar with fibromyalgia, and there's some that just really want to have you pull the whole thing. Pacing. Anything that flares your pain up back down to where it doesn't, find out where that threshold is, and do it off. The effects of the exercise on these neurotransmitters only last about a day and a half, so you have to do it 4 or 5 days a week. But you know the threshold of kicking the symptoms up.
Okay, well, my doctor gave me Xanax that he said that would help.
Xanax?
Yeah, that would help with the nerves and stuff like that, which, I mean, do you think that really does help? Because I just don't feel like it's doing anything.
Well, it's an interesting question. Usually Xanax is not used because it's so short acting and you get this up and down phenomenon. There's some things like it that last longer. It can help the restless legs, that sometimes is part of this, and does quiet down the sympathetic overdrive. But in studies of benzodiazepines, that group of things, 4-fibro, they can help quiet the anxiety, but they don't really help the pain much. And they interfere with your deep sleep, which is an important third target for the treatment. You talked about SNRIs and the like, the anticonvulsants. The sleep is crucial. And it needs to improve deep sleep and benzo block your sleep.
Plus, they're very, you get habituated to them.
I'm sorry?
Plus, I'm just saying you get habituated to them.
Yeah,
and they need more and more and more.
Yeah, more. They can be habituated, that's true.
So what do you suggest for deep sleep?
Oh,
you get
yeah.
up in the morning and you're exhausted.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, that's a whole discussion. However, there are two parts. There are some of the medications that work for fibro to improve deep sleep. Gabapentin and pregabalin improves deep sleep. Trazodone improves deep sleep and has been shown to somewhat improve the pain of fibromyalgia by itself. Ambien and benzos don't improve the pain, they'll put you to sleep, but they don't improve the pain. There's a host of these medicines that are used to help the bipolar mechanism that really improve the deep sleep. We did a study using a thing called sodium oxybate. It's like the old date break drug. It really gives you good deep sleep. It's hard to get because of that. But it, using that alone in this fibro study, you got about the same response rates as you see with these other approved drugs. Now, that's the drug side of it. You can train yourself. Okay, so what you want to do is condition your mind, use some of these medications temporarily, but you do deep relaxation techniques like progressive muscle relaxation and other breathing techniques. And you condition with the medication and the deep relaxation to get the deep sleep. And then after about a month, your brain becomes conditioned that when I do the deep relaxation, I fall into deep sleep, and you can often back off and sleep. So there's some behavioral things that are very useful in the long run, better than medications for sleep.
What about ibuprofen? Or
I have a couple of things that I'd like to add. Number one, make sure you've had your sleep evaluated. If you haven't had a sleep study, that might be a good thing. And the other thing is hypnosis sometimes is really valuable for learning to sleep well.
The hypnosis is just deep relaxation. Let down your barriers. And this point about a sleep test is well worth thinking about. About in my practice, about a fourth of people with fibromyalgia have sleep apnea. And if you don't treat that, you never get into deep sleep, and none of these things work well. If you're snoring, if you have daytime sleepiness, you have morning headaches, get a sleep test.
We'll have to cut it off here. I really hate that we could go on for 9 hours.
Thank you.